What is climate change? Climate change is a change in global or regional climate patterns, in particular, a change apparent from the mid to late 20th century onwards, and attributed largely to the increased levels of atmospheric carbon dioxide produced by the use of fossil fuels. Climate change is also known as global warming. Climate change is blamed for the continual catastrophic events that continue to happen in the world, such as floods, famines, heat waves, fires, etc. Climate change is even being held responsible for extending summers, and thereby increasing the chances of the Zika virus. Because of these things, many groups and societies in existence for other reasons, such as churches or scientific communities, and groups which have been formed solely because of climate change, are all coming together and forming a massive force to wage war against the climate. Many examples of these include the Pacific Climate Warriors Movement, National Association of Marine Laboratories, Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics, Society of Systematic Biologists, University Corporation for Atmospheric Research, American Public Health Association, Young Evangelicals for Climate Change, Evangelical Environment Network, Citizens Climate Lobby, African Methodist Episcopal Church, the Africa Group of Negotiators, the Climate Group, which has offices in Beijing, Hong Kong, New Delhi, New York, and London, the group Time to Act, the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, or OPEC, the CACAM, which is Central Asia, Caucasus, Albania, and Moldova, AILAC, the Independent Alliance of Latin America and the Caribbean, BASIC, Brazil, South Africa, China, and India, the Coalition for Rainforest Nations, Bolivarian Alliance for Peoples of Our America, etc. People all over the world are joining some group or are already part of some group putting forth their efforts to stop climate change. At this point, whether you believe if climate change is happening or not doesn't matter. And whether you believe if we can do anything about the climate doesn't matter either. What is about to happen is going to affect every single person on the planet, including you. Climate change is going to be the vehicle for the enforcement of religious law in America first, and then consequently this entire world. This world is looking for peace. Peace between people of different genders, different races, different religions, different sexual orientations, and general differences on the views of life. Climate change is the bridge that all these different groups of people are meeting upon. The enforcement of religious laws will not come to the dismay of the general population, because it will be seen as the missing link to solve our climate issues and bring our world into greater harmony. There are many faiths in this world, and one of the biggest faiths in this world is Christianity. The majority of the American population are Christians, and many of these Christian churches and people within them are open about their war on climate change, including the Anglican, Baptist, Church of the Brethren, or Creation Care, Eastern Orthodox, Episcopal, Evangelicals, Methodists, Presbyterians, Quakers, Roman Catholics, Unitarian Universalist Association, United Church of Christ, and then we have ecumenical groups such as the Creation Justice Ministries, the Pastoral Message of Climate Change, and the World Council of Churches. This combined force in America will cause religious law to be legislated and enforced. The American churches have something called a 501c3. The 501c3 grants the churches in America their tax-free status. However, the 501c3 limits freedom of speech in the church. If the churches preach on something like the upcoming elections and it's reported to the IRS, the churches will be subject to losing their tax-free status and will be subject to excessive fines, since they are now to be considered government agencies. The churches have literally become church and state entities. But while the churches lose their right for freedom of speech, in exchange for a tax-free status, the churches have also obtained power from the government to lobby law. The 501c3 grants the American churches the ability to suggest and cause religious law to be legislated and enforced in America. But again, the legislation of religious law will not come to the general population as something hazardous, because while they are already binding themselves together for unity and peace, they being people of like faith, different faith, or even those without faith, they are also looking for a solution to put an end to climate change. Even the United Nations has a goal towards climate change, and stating that they must take urgent action to combat climate change and its impact. This same message is being repeated around the entire world. There is a sudden, urgent call around this planet to deal with climate change. TickRoot of Newsweek.com, in a March 18, 2016 article entitled "An Evangelical Movement Takes on Climate Change," said, "The interfaith section of the 2014 People's Climate March in New York City saw thousands of people from more than 30 faiths, Baptist, Zoroastrian, and everything in between, rally for climate change. The World Council of Churches, representing hundreds of millions of Christians, has committed to divesting its multi-million dollar endowment from fossil fuels. At December's historic climate summit in Paris, there were morning worship groups, Vatican negotiators, and an exhibit at Notre Dame Cathedral called Ode to God's Creation. None of this was really on the horizon 20 years ago, says Mary Evelyn Tucker, co-director of the Forum on Religion and Ecology at Yale University. There has been an explosion. Mary Evelyn Tucker is exactly correct. There absolutely has been an explosion of groups of people seeking to combat and do something in an explosive effort to combat climate change. On May 24th, 2015, Pope Francis published his encyclical Laudato Si, Praise Be to You, on care for our common home. In this encyclical, Pope Francis addressed what we can do together as humanity, calling for global action to deal with climate change. Less than 1 year later, in December 2015, 195 countries adopted the historic, first-ever, universal, legally binding global climate deal at Paris, at the Paris Climate Conference, COP21. And in April 22nd, 2016, more than 160 nations signed the historic climate change agreement to limit global warming to below 2 degrees Celsius. These worldwide movements came in response less than 1 year to the Pope's encyclical on climate change. The response was quick. The response is urgent. In his encyclical, Pope Francis says in paragraph 26, addressing pollution and the climate, "There is an urgent need to develop policy so that in the next few years, the emission of carbon dioxide and other highly polluting gases can be drastically reduced, for example, substituting for fossil fuels and developing sources of renewable energy. Worldwide, there is minimal access to clean and renewable energy. There is still a need to develop adequate storage technologies. Some countries have made considerable progress, although it is far from constituting a significant proportion. Investments have also been made in means of production and transportation, which consume less energy and require fewer raw materials, as well as in methods of construction and renovating buildings, which improve their energy efficiency. But these good practices are still far from widespread. While suggesting solutions for dealing with climate change in a secular or technical manner, Francis also recommends a spiritual or religious solution, which will eventually be enforced as religious law by the Churches of America. His religious solution deals not only with the earth, but with our relationships towards the poor and towards each other and towards God. What is this solution? Keeping Sabbath. In subheading The Wisdom of Biblical Events in paragraph 71, he says that all it takes is one good person to restore hope when he's speaking of Noah. He continues to say, the biblical tradition clearly shows that this renewal entails recovering and respecting the rhythms inscribed in nature by the hand of the Creator. We see this, for example, in the law of the Sabbath. On the seventh day, God rested from all his work. He commanded Israel to set aside each seventh day as a day of rest, a Sabbath. The Pope continues to go on, speaking of a sabbatical year, which was set aside for Israel, you know, a complete rest for the land, when sowing was forbidden and one reaped only what was necessary to stay alive on and to feed one's household. And he also mentioned the Jubilee. And in paragraph 237, he says that Sunday, like the Jewish Sabbath, is meant to be a day which heals our relationships with God, with ourselves, and with others, and with this world. He continues to say, rest opens our eyes to the larger picture and gives us renewed sensitivity to the rights of others. And so, the day of rest, centered on the Eucharist, sheds its light on the whole week and motivates us to greater concern for nature and the poor. The Pope's religious solution to climate change, which not only deals with climate change, but our connection to the poor, our family and our connection to our neighbors and God, is rest. Rest for nature. Rest with each other. By keeping Sabbath. This Sabbath or Sunday solution will be enacted in America first, and then the entire world. Impossible? Have you ever heard of the Blue Laws? A Blue Law is a state or local law that prohibits commercial activities on Sunday. Blue Laws have been a part of U.S. legal history since the colonial period. These laws, which today are usually referred to as Sunday closing laws, prohibit certain types of commercial activity on Sundays. Originally, these laws were directed at personal activities regarded as moral offenses, such as gambling or the consumption of alcohol. In the 19th century, however, state and local governments passed laws that forbade businesses from operating on Sunday. Although these laws were clearly based on Christian beliefs, the U.S. Supreme Court has ruled that they do not violate the First Amendment's Establishment Clause. Many blue laws have been repealed since the 1960s, but some laws that ban the sale of alcohol on Sunday remain in force. So although this Sunday day of rest comes specifically from Catholic beliefs and can only be defended by Catholic principles, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that these laws do not violate the First Amendment's Establishment Clause. Literally, religious Sunday laws can be enforced in America and be seen as no violation of our First Amendment rights. The truth behind this is not nearly as far-fetched as some might make it to seem. The war on climate change has waxed spiritual. On December 2nd, 2015, in an article called Our Common Home, Times of Malta writer Emmanuel writes this. Pope Francis calls these radical proposals as concrete steps of ecological conversion, which demands a different lifestyle. In their reports, the European bishops say that climate change is only one symptom of the unsustainable way of life, modes of production, and patterns of consumption that have evolved in the industrialized world. It is then clear that exclusively technical solutions or a reduction in the greenhouse gas emissions alone cannot solve the problem of sustainability. Ecological conversion also means dealing with time differently, both as an individual and as a society. We need to rediscover the rhythm of time, the alternation between work and rest, with Sunday as the commonly shared weekly day of rest. I implore every ear that stands behind this climate change movement, or against it, to take a step back and see where this is going. On July 27, 2016, Huffington Post writer Laura Storm headlines her article, "Wise Spiritual Leadership is the Key to Solve Climate Change." In this article, she states, "I have never really considered myself a spiritual being or given it much thought. To be honest, I've always thought spirituality has a weird vibe to it, or even an annoying form of arrogance, an exclusive club for the enlightened few that we normal people could never fully understand. But this past year, something has happened in the world and with me personally that has fully changed my perception." The first phase of the Green Faith in Action was a series of sessions bringing together top leaders from business, politics, religions, and NGOs led by the Regions 20 that has spent the past 5 years helping regions implement low-carbon solutions. A monastery in Switzerland set the scene for our first meeting. At this session, we sat down in silence, held each other's hands, shared our inner dreams, and generally allowed time to connect with the person behind the title. To me, it was uncomfortable at first. I felt annoyed and impatient. In my usual high tempo, action-oriented business mode, I desperately wanted to convert the meeting into a classic business meeting with action points and delegation of tasks and responsibilities. Instead, something far more powerful happened. We were allowed time to step back and reflect on the higher purpose of our work, and through a reconnection with our own purpose, we created an energized and passionate momentum. No traditional business meeting could ever have accomplished this. Our group went on to help the French president, the host of the COP21, facilitate the Summit of Conscience, gathering religious and political leaders, climate negotiators, artists, and CEOs. It wasn't a traditional high-level summit, but a day dedicated to allow these leaders to step out of the traditional structures and procedures that normally dominate high-level gatherings. Instead of hiding behind prepared speeches of somewhat superficial government declarations, all leaders were asked to address why they cared about the planet and what they would do to ensure their grandchildren would have a place to live and thrive. The summit became a very emotional day, and is said to have played a huge part in ensuring a successful political outcome at the COP21 in Paris. It took away the placing of blame and fighting over targets, and instead allowed space for connecting with what was really at stake at the COP21. The well-being of our planet, and thereby the well-being of life on Earth. We do see a slow shift towards leadership that values the importance of an inner connection, as well as a commitment to a higher purpose. The concept of conscious capitalism, coined by Walmart CEO John Mackey and Ray Sisodia, the adoption of mindfulness and meditation among top executives, and the impressive sleep revolution by Arianna Huffington, are all examples of a shift in mindset and leadership. This shift is critical if we are to solve the greatest challenge of mankind, climate change. Leaders have to stop hiding behind a narrow-minded focus on quarterly regions and the delusion that this environmental thing is not of relevance to their shareholders. No man or company is an island. Our survival is dependent on the well-being of our planet. The events of this past year have forever changed me, and I cannot wait to venturing back into the world doing what I love, helping sustainable solutions and ideas scale, with a greater respect and understanding of spiritual leadership practice. I truly believe that if CEOs prioritize time to connect with themselves and the planet
they inhabit,
we would see a radical shift in mindset and business practice. A business practice focused on creating value and profits from products and services that were in sync with our own boundaries as well as the boundaries of this planet we call home. So you see, part of the success behind climate change and the COP21 Paris Agreement in December 2015 is the spirituality that is now behind it. The battle against climate change is experiencing a shift. On April 4th, 2016, Rachel Lamb wrote in the Charlotte Observer, "Surprising to some, we are coming together to pray about climate change because of our faith, not in spite of it. For too long, this issue has been so heavily politicized that minds are made up before it is considered from a spiritual and moral perspective. This is too important an issue to be avoided, because some have branded it with unhelpful political rhetoric." And on July 26, 2016, Mark Silk of Religion News wrote, "A year ago, Pope Francis issued the encyclical Laudato Si, his clarion call for international action to address the existential crisis of climate change. Yesterday, the Democratic Party signaled it's with the program by approving a platform that recognizes climate change as an urgent threat and a defining challenge of our time. Of greatest significance is a section on global threats that declares the United States must take the lead in forging a robust global solution to the climate crisis. Here's what that means. We are committed to a national mobilization and to leading a global effort to mobilize nations to address this threat on a scale not seen since World War II. In the first 100 days of the next administration, the president will convene a summit of the world's best engineers, climate scientists, policy experts, activists, and indigenous communities to chart a course to solve the climate crisis. Speaking of the Roman Catholic influence, or as the author Sidney Pereira calls it, the Francis effect, she says this under the subheading, "Australian Catholic Organizations Divest, Catholic Schools Go Solar." Four organizations publicly divested from coal, oil, and gas extraction industries in the June anniversary of Laudato Si, the Pope's encyclical. The organizations that divested are Presentation Congregation Queensland, Presentation Sisters Wagga Wagga, Marist Sisters Australia, and the Passionists, Holy Spirit Province. The announcement was facilitated by the Australian Religious Response to Climate Change, which also released an open letter from several religious leaders urging those in public office to act on climate change in the wake of the Great Barrier Reef's coral bleaching. Now, there are a host of other articles clearly showing the religious nature that is beginning to take place in this climate change movement. The Pope published his encyclical, and in less than a year, we have historic movements towards dealing with climate change. It is even declared that spiritual leadership is the key that is needed to take care of our changing climate. The Christian Church is responding to the call, such as the one Robert Parham made in 2014, saying, "For real climate change progress, we need the full support of the most active and fastest growing segment of Christianity around the world." Those of us concerned about climate change and its adverse impact on the poor must double up efforts to connect with people in spaces where the Christian faith is still thriving. The Christian Church, in response to this and in response to Pope Francis's encyclical, will cause, by their power granted to them in the American government's 501c3, Sunday laws to be enforced. Talking points for this law have been brought up throughout the years, and some very blatant comments in favor of such laws to help the climate. For example, The Guardian's Satish Kumar headlines his article, "Slow Sunday, the Simple Solution to Global Warming," saying in it that using Sunday as a day of rest and renewal would be good for our personal health as well as the health of the planet. He later states that one thing we can easily do to achieve this goal, we can declare Sunday to be a fossil fuel free day, or a low carbon day, or at least an energy saving day. In the Salvation Army's A Call for Climate Justice, it says this for helping the climate: keep the Sabbath. It could be the most radical thing a church can do for environmental stewardship, to commit to keeping the Sabbath. The scriptures make constant reference to rest and care for the land as well as for people on the Sabbath. Spending time with families and friends and enjoying the free outdoors is an act of resistance to the pressures of materialism and consumerism. And before we think that only Christians will find value in this, we find in this article written on April 29th, 2016, which is headlined, "Regardless of Your Religion, Our Increasingly Busy Lives Require a Sabbath Day of Rest." In that article, it states, "I believe God instituted Sabbath observance as a law for our benefit. Whatever our religious background, God wants us to be rested and refreshed. If at all possible, take time for your own Sabbath rest, whenever you can find it." Quoted as principles contained in the Constitution of the original organization, which was then called the American Sabbath Union, cited in the Lord's Day Alliance 25th report from 1913, it says, "This organization proposes in every way possible to aid in preserving Sunday as a civil institution. Our national security requires the active support of all good citizens in the maintenance of our American Sabbath." Sunday laws must be enforced. In the Catechism of the Catholic Church, number 2188, it says, "In respecting religious liberty and the common good of all, Christians should seek recognition of Sundays and the Church's holy days as legal holidays." John Paul II, in his Dies Domini in 1998, says, "Therefore also, in the particular circumstances of our time, Christians will naturally strive to ensure that civil legislation respects their duty to keep Sunday holy." In the post-synodal apostolic exhortation, Sacramentum Caritatis, from February 22, 2007, by Pope Benedict XVI, it says in paragraph 74, "Finally, it is particularly urgent nowadays to remember that the day of the Lord is also a day of rest from work. It is greatly to be hoped that this fact will also be recognized by civil society, so that individuals can be permitted to refrain from work without being penalized." In 2015, Belfast Telegraph posts, "Rest on Sunday helps us all, not just Christians." And within it states that Christians are not the only ones opposed to further relaxation of Sunday trading laws. You see, this is the battle that is being waged right now. A Sunday Sabbath for the entire world, that is, the inhabitants of the world, and for nature itself to protect us and it from the nefarious effects of climate change, and to bless the people. H.F. Thomas, Chancellor of Cardinal Gibbons, on November 11, 1895, says, "Of course the Catholic Church claims the change Saturday Sabbath to Sunday was her act, and the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical authority in religious things. The Roman Catholic Church views the Sunday Sabbath, that day of rest, as her mark of authority and is ever striving to have her religious power legislated into civil society. The American churches will eventually, through the lobbying power granted to them in the 501c3, enforce the Catholic Church's religious law, causing all to bow down before the authority of the Roman Catholic Church. And as with any government law, expect punishment for not obeying." And what are those types of things that will happen to those who refuse to bow down to this church and government-mandated law? The same as before. Sebastian Frank, in 1536, said that some have suffered torture because they would not rest when others kept Sunday, for they declared it to be the holiday and law of Antichrist. The Catholic Record of London, Ontario, on September 1st, 1923, says, "Sunday is our mark of authority. The Church is above the Bible, and this transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact." The leaders of this church are so bold, the comments made so arrogant, that they literally believe they have authority over the commandments of the God they claim to worship. Now, if they claim to have so much authority over even God Himself, what hope does the rest of the civilized world have? I want you to pay close attention to these next statements. And the Decretal, De Tranlatic Episcopop cap. The Pope can modify divine law. In Ferraris Ecclesiastical Dictionary, it says the Pope has the power to change times, to abrogate laws, and to dispense with all things, even the precepts of Christ. The Pope has the authority, and often exercised it, to dispense with the command of Christ. Look at the striking similarity with this comment to Bible prophecy. In Daniel chapter 7 verse 25 it says, "And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear up the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws. And they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time." Father Enright, CSSR of the Redemptoral College in Kansas City, writes in History of the Sabbath on page 802, "The Bible says, remember that thou keep holy the Sabbath day. The Catholic Church says, no. By my divine power, I abolish the Sabbath day and command you to keep the first day of the week. And lo, the entire civilized world bows down in reverent obedience to the command of the Holy Catholic Church." Of course, Mr. Enright is talking about the Ten Commandments, the fourth of which says in Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 to 11, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day, and hallowed it." The Catholic Church claims to have abolished the Sabbath day and substituted Sunday, the first day of the week, in replacement, and is striving and teaching Christians that they should strive for Sunday laws to be enforced by civil authority. Climate change is the very vehicle that is being used for the enforcement of these laws. Blue laws have already been in existence in America, and although they have a clear Catholic basis, they have not been ruled unconstitutional. The Catholic Church teaches that the seventh day rest does not remain any longer for Christians to observe, but that the first day is to be the day of rest for Christians and for the entire civilized world. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 4 to 5 and verse 9 say this: "For he spake in a certain place, he being God, of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest. There remaineth therefore a rest of the people of God." The word rest in verse 9 is originally the Greek word sabbatismos, which means a keeping Sabbath. Hebrews 4 plainly declares that God's rest is the one taken on the seventh day, and this seventh day rest, this sabbatismos, still remaineth, or it is still in effect unto this day. The prophet Ezekiel says in Ezekiel 20:20, "And hallow my Sabbaths, and they shall be a sign between me and you, that ye may know that I am the Lord your God." As the Sabbath is God's sign between him and his people, so the Sunday Sabbath is a sign between the Catholic Church and those who will obey her. Revelation chapter 14, verses 9 through 12. "And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, If any man worship the beast," which is the Roman Catholic Church, "and his image," which are the American churches, which, thanks to the 501c3, are a church and state agency, just like the Catholic Church. "Therefore, bearing the same image of a woman," church, "riding upon a beast," kingdom, "and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand," not a physical mark, but as Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 18, and Proverbs chapter 1, verses 8 to 9 says, "The words that are the commandments of God or of others are to be laid upon your hands and forehead." Verse 10, "The same shall drink the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb." Verse 11, "And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast in his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name." Verse 12, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus." Who are those who escape the mark of the authority of the Roman Catholic Church? Those who, quote, "keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus." The saints are those who keep all of God's Ten Commandments, including the Sabbath, and have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and Savior. They keep the true seventh-day biblical Sabbath, and not the first day of the week, which this entire world is going to put into law. So what now? Repent and resist. Turn your hearts to the true God. Whether you're an atheist, Buddhist, Christian, Muslim, Taoist, anything, everyone needs to repent and turn their hearts to the true God of creation. Bible prophecy is fulfilling. It is essential that once we have turned our hearts to God and studied the prophecies, and you'll see the truth, that we turn around and we resist this church and we resist this movement. Share this video and by pen and voice, resist the enforcement of Sunday laws and resist, again, this climate change movement before your religious liberty is swallowed up, forcing you into churches on Sundays, forbidding your own secular labor practices. Be bold and stand up for religious freedom. No law that deals specifically with the worship of any god can be forced into law in America. And regardless of whether you are in America or not, resist, because as we see, the entire world is clamoring after this climate change movement. And soon the very same authority of the Catholic Church will be in your area. Escape this church and her laws as if your very life depended upon it. Because it does. Stanley Mushava, entitled in an article named Zimbabwe Church, State, and Climate Change from January 15th of this year, says Zimbabwe had a respite from searing temperatures this week as rains fell in parts of the country concurrently with the presidential call to prayer. The cropping season is in jeopardy, as the country has come under the debilitating trail of climate change. No easy test for the principally agro-based economy. Could Zimbabwe, with the rest of the world, be on call to repent and seek God anew? It is not hard to settle for such a conviction, given the concurrence of moral degeneration in climate change. As you see, prayer was called for, the rain came, and now the conviction that is being settled upon is that the world is being called to repent and seek God anew. The climate change battle is waxing spiritual. And so Sunday, the law of the Catholic Church will be enforced. As the American Sentinel says, In June 1893. Sunday, it is the law of the Catholic Church alone. Science Daily says, of the more than a billion global fires that burned between the years 2001 and 2013, Sunday was the least active day, with only 104 million fires. Fires are more prevalent on a Tuesday and less likely on a Sunday, according to a new study which highlights the dramatic effects humans, religion, and culture have on the global climate. Thanks for watching. God bless.